We know the funeral that's conflicting with this, unfortunately, but one of those things, but the people that will see it on the video, we're on Channel 4 going on, so we'll be videotaped for that. Delighted to have everybody here. This is one of those things that we didn't know was going to happen, but did. I got an email from someone named Jeremiah Goulka, and it's asking about book reviews. I'm the editor of, book review editor of Maine History, and that brought in something that a little discussion about his book, and would he be able to be a book reviewer and all that sort of stuff, and led to this discussion. And why don't you come to Maine? When you come to Maine, why don't you come to Bethel and talk to us about Joshua Chamberlain? And so that was how this all began, and it's one of those things you just never know how these things are going to happen. And delighted to have him here today, and hopefully we'll be delighted with his, I'm sure we'll be delighted with his presentation. I just want to give a little background that those of us who took Bob York's history course, Maine History, remember 1964 I took that course, and when I was an undergraduate at the University of Southern Maine. And Bob, of course, was the champion lecturer of all time, and of course, the most knowledgeable person on Maine history there ever was, probably. He was state historian from 1956 until 2003. Imagine how long a tour of duty that is. And I stayed as a friend of his all those years. And in those days, to get into the Maine Historical Society, you had to have had to apply for admission and be accepted, you know, in those days. And Bob sponsored me, so I always had that. To his, always owed him that for that introduction to the Maine Historical Society. Anyway, that was the beginning of our knowledge of Chamberlain. We've been telling people this for years, that Chamberlain was one of the great figures of the Civil War. It took till Gettysburg and Killer Angels, a few things like that, that the rest of the world found out about the glory of Joshua Chamberlain. But Bob had told us for years, and everyone else who had him as a history teacher, was teaching Maine history, always said that too, and so I'm delighted now that Chamberlain now has come into his own. We also want to remember that Chamberlain came to the funeral of Clark Edwards, the commander of the 5th Maine, in 1903, when we published a photograph of it in the Courier back, a few years back, and you see Chamberlain definitely sitting right there in the second or third row. The universe was now the Nazarene Church, was then the Universalist Church. So he did come here at least once, and we verified it by newspaper accounts as well. But on to our speaker, and Jeremiah Goulka tells me he grew up in Dallas and Chicago. He had the good sense to go to Bowdoin. He graduated in 1997, is that correct? And he has had a distinguished career after that. He was went to study law at the University of Edinburgh, and also taught in the history department. He also had spent some time at the University of Paris, and he was at Northwestern where he was a business scholar, and he finally finished up his law degree at the University of Chicago Law School. He's now an attorney in Washington, D.C., and an independent scholar, and I'm also very pleased to know that he's going to be a reviewer for Maine History now, so we've got a book, we've signed him already, so he's all on the road to being a reviewer. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Jeremiah for a talk on Joshua Chamberlain, and hopefully, let's give him a good Bethel Historical Society welcome.
Thanks, Stan, for bringing me here. It's been a really nice day, a gorgeous day in Maine. Thanks for coming inside for an hour on a beautiful day like this. It's a rather extraordinary setup they have here at the Historical Society. These two buildings, the building they're hoping to build, an extension next door, and then having lunch at Stan's house. Extraordinary. Well, Stan and I were talking before about his professor at who believed that Chamberlain did not get his due for a long time. Now he's widely known, widely famous again, but within his own life, there's the question of him getting his due is something I want to talk about today. Mm-hmm. Today is the 140th anniversary of Appomattox, by the way. So it's sort of timely. A couple of months afterwards, Chamberlain wrote a friend of his, a New York lawyer, from the headquarters of the 1st Division of the 5th Corps of the Army of the Potomac. The old Army of the Potomac is gone. In a few days, we expect to be broken up by explicit orders and distributed and assigned in widely different places. I have no idea of my own fate. To my great astonishment, I learned that General Meade has sent my name to the president with a few others, all by far my seniors and superiors, for the full appointment of Major General. I appreciate the compliment at this time when the effort is to get rid of officers. But my feeling now is that I shall return very soon to my private life. Soldiering in time of peace is almost as much against my grain as being a peaceman in time of war. My wounds, too, I find, now that I am called on no longer to bear up against them, are very troublesome, and I need to be fitted at home a while. Chamberlain was not sure what he was going to do when he went home. What was he going to do? How would he adjust from war? How would he adjust to going back home, to his hometown? How would his life change now that he was a celebrity? He was a war hero. And what sort of opportunities would he choose among those that he was offered? What roles would allow his leadership style to flourish in civilian life? See, these are some of the questions that I want to talk about with you today. Just for a quick background, for those who don't know the chronology of his life, he was born in 1828 in Brewer, went for 1 year when he was 14 to a military academy, and he went to Bowdoin College. Afterwards, he went to the Bangor Theological Seminary with an interest in becoming a missionary. He married the daughter of the church minister that's right next to Bowdoin's campus. He taught rhetoric and oratory and languages at Bowdoin for a few years. His early married life, had some children, and in 1862, joined the 20th Maine as lieutenant colonel, went off to war. He was promoted colonel right before Gettysburg, and there's a little round top. In 1864, at Petersburg, he was severely injured with a shot that pierced his hips. He was promoted to Brigadier General right afterwards, on what they thought was his deathbed. He was brevetted to Major General at the end of the war. He accepted the official surrender of the infantry of the Army of Northern Virginia at Appomattox. He came home, was elected governor, served four terms at a time when they were one-year terms. So that was 1867 to 71. He was aged 39 to 43 at that time. He was then president of Bowdoin College for 12 years, until 1883, and until he was 55. Then he went into business, which he did until he was about 72, around 1900, and then he worked at the Customs House in Portland until his death in 1914. One thing to keep in mind all the way through this is that we think of him as a hero. That's why we're interested in him originally. And in fact, most of his life, when you look at brief biographies of him, everything's cast heroically in his life. He studied his way into Bowdoin. He conquered his stammer. Everything was heroic. The interesting thing to realize is that he's not just seen as a hero now. He was seen as a hero then. All through his life, he was a popular, celebrated war hero. He was known as the Grand Old Man of Maine. So in 1865, what does he do? In 1862, he had written his wife from the battlefield to say, "Let me say, no danger and no hardship ever makes me wish to get back to that college life again. I can't breathe when I think of those last 2 years. Why, I would spend my whole life campaigning it rather than endure that again." He went back to the college. He was bored. It was a hard transition for him. Though he was actually given the interim presidency of the college, his mind wasn't there. yet it was a hard time adjusting. It's always hard to adjust any time you go back home from something. This is from war. Well, he'd become a public figure. He's lecturing fairly widely, giving historical lectures, appearing at the opening of soldiers' homes and orphans' homes. He started working on a history of the Fifth Corps of the Army of the Potomac with several other officers. But before he could get too bored, politics interrupted. In April of 1866, he wrote his wife, Fanny, to say, "I am summoned to Augusta today by a dispatch to see some of these gentlemen interested in having me nominated, I suppose. I hate these things." Well, that starts to give a hint as to how he's going to take politics during his whole political career. But he was ready for some public service. He'd really come alive as a public servant, as a soldier fighting in a war that he believed in. So his notions of duty continue to be connected to that, as well as all of the style of the rhetoric of the time and of Victorian rhetoric. He writes to, in 1869, to the main Republican nominating committee, which was encouraging him, nominating him to be governor again at his third term. The language he uses fits the language he would have accepted originally with. "You call me in the most sacred names of service, of duty, of devotion. I hear the summons as the bugle call to action, and I obey. Those whom I love, it is right that I should also serve." Now, he had been a general. He had a habit of command. This was a leadership role. And it was he was a war celebrity, a war hero, and so the banners in the campaign that was run for him said, "For governor, the gallant Chamberlain." As governor, he was involved in promoting several economic development programs in Maine, helping to develop the University of Maine system. But he was not a happy politician. He did not enjoy it. He was not a partisan politician. And at the time, the leadership of the Maine Republican Party had control of what was essentially a very strong political machine. And in those days, politics was frankly more partisan than it is now. Chamberlain was not ever comfortable with partisan politics. Besides, state politics never offered the clear morality of war. As he wrote, actually, after he was governor, towards the end of his presidency, actually, at the college, he was returning from Florida, and he was in Washington, D.C., and he wrote his sister from, after visiting many of the congressmen and senators, visiting the Capitol, he wrote, "Self-seeking marks too many faces, and all the strifes of peaceful times, less noble than those of war, are here spread in their little play." It's not the words of someone who was a natural politician. In fact, later, after he was governor, he wrote to his sister that, "What ails me is that I am staggered by seeing both sides of a question. I could never be a partisan leader, a man of one idea. I see the whole combination and am perplexed till the time comes for me to strike in. I can go in then and see clear as it will." This is not the leadership style of a natural politician. This is a general. It was going to be hard for him in politics. The public loved him. He was wildly popular. He won by landslide elections. He won the biggest landslide in Maine's history at that point, and he was elected to an unprecedented fourth term. But he was the meritocratic, intellectual governor, and the machine was not happy about him. He was a maverick. He did not kowtow to the machine. They viewed him as an intellectual Johnny come lately who sneered at them. And there were times that he seemed to go out of his way to kind of insult them. Politics did not offer him what's known as the moral equivalent of war. clear morality of any moment on the battlefield. You're fighting for a cause, clear what you have to do. Politics is a lot more mushy than that. So, towards the end of his tenure as governor, he wrote a letter. To His Majesty William, King of Prussia. Sire, the undersigned respectfully presents to Your Majesty the tender of his services in the war now opening in Europe, the Franco-Prussian War. He has the honor to refer to the fact that he has served through all grades from field officer to that of general division. His last two promotions were made on the field of battle under circumstances which warrant him in referring to them as testimony of his capacity. The office he now holds of governor of the state of Maine, he proposes to resign in case Your Majesty shall be pleased to accept his service. While no great principle of international right is involved in the present impending war, the honor of manhood is a point on which a soldier may well be sensitive. In this feeling and sympathizing with Your Majesty's political and personal attitude, well acquainted with your language and admiring your people, I tender the best service of my sort. Your Majesty's most obedient servant, Joshua L. Chamberlain, Governor and Commander-in-Chief of the State of Maine. Well, he never became a mercenary. He did, however, seek a Senate seat, and he would ultimately seek the Senate seat 3 times. He was ambitious, but he never had the hunger, the real hunger that you need to be a successful politician. And at the time, senators were chosen by the state legislatures, which meant the political leadership, essentially. They weren't about to let him take the Senate seat. So that just never went forward. What to do now? He's not happy as a politician. Even as an executive leadership role, wasn't a collegial role, it was an actual the governor's seat. Well, he looked elsewhere, and an opportunity opened for him to go to a place that he knew, that he loved, cared about, and where he had tried to do some reforms before the war. The presidency of Bowdoin College was open, and they welcomed the war hero to come in, make some reforms, lead. Chamberlain always wrote letters to his mother on his birthday, so on September 8th of his first year as president, he wrote, "My dear mother, I have been full of business all day, and it is almost 12 at night, but I will not miss my letter, for the birthdays are never forgotten by me. I have to thank you for many things, not the least of them is the right care and training, which have given me a strong constitution and a cheerful mind. I find everything working pleasantly in regard to my opening a larger field for the college to work in. It looks as if I could do some good here, and I could stand a great deal of hard work." And at the outset, he came in and he commanded. He doubled the size of the college, he opened up science and engineering departments, he liberalized the course of study, liberalized the social code, and created a mandatory military science program under the feeling that America had been unready for war. But it was hard going. These were a lot of changes, and fast. A year and a half into his tenure, he wrote a former senator, "Nothing has occurred here to depress me especially, for there is an increasing interest on the part of the students, and a greatly increasing tendency towards this college among young men who are fitting for a liberal course of study. But knowing as I do the small means we have to work with, the small capital we are doing business on, and knowing also that our best professors will surely leave us before long, prosperous as we are in numbers, I feel that it is of the most pressing importance that we secure the countenance and aid of liberal men in our state. I have boldly written several of them, but see no results as yet." His correspondence at the time was full of fundraising letters. He was the college president, as college presidents do. But it was difficult, and in the 1870s, an economic slump hit the country. It made it especially hard. So funds dried up somewhat. the end of that year, he wrote a letter to the trustees and overseers of Bowdoin College, saying, "Gentlemen, when I assumed the duties to which you honored me on my election, I was aware that they involved difficulties and trials from which older and abler men than I had retired. I have exerted myself beyond any previous experience to be equal to this place and to meet your wishes. I hoped to succeed, but I have not met my own expectation. A spirit seems to possess the college with which I cannot harmonize and under which I cannot advantageously work. I owe the world some better service, and it is my duty to seek it. Grateful for the many kind and generous words with which you have endeavored to support and aid me, I respectfully tender my resignation of the presidency of Bowdoin College." Well, it wasn't accepted. He stayed 10 more years. But they were not years of vigorous reform like his first couple of years. The economy slowed down. And the event happened shortly thereafter, which in Bowdoin lore is the most famous aspect of his presidency. The military science program. Students liked it at first. It's kind of fun. They got dressed up, marched around. The federal government provided weapons. They learned to shoot. They learned to act like soldiers. But there were requirements. You had to do it an hour almost every day. It would rain. It was cold outside. This is Maine in the winter. No one wants to go outside and march around. Uniforms were expensive, and they had to buy them. So after a while, the first three classes, the freshmen, sophomore, and juniors, rebelled. They refused to do it. They quit. Well, Chamberlain, ever the soldier, his honor besmirched by this, expelled them all. Well, you can't really expel a whole school, you know. Though he actually joked that he had increased the size of school so much that the mere senior class staying on campus was a bigger college than it had been when he was a student. Still, he needed to have some more students, so he allowed them to return with the proviso. They could come back if they swore an oath of allegiance to the college. Sound kind of familiar? Well, it came back. It became an elective. It lasted about another year, and then they just closed off the program. Funny thing is, he was ahead of his time. In the 1890s, these programs became really popular nationwide and are the precursors of ROTC programs. Then in 1876, while he's still president, Chamberlain got the taste for politics again. It started in March of 1876 when Senator Lot Morrill resigned his Senate seat to take position as Secretary of the Treasury. The resignation of Senator Morrill is providential and places the governor in a position of great responsibility, Chamberlain wrote to Thomas Wentworth Hyde, Bowdoin graduate, trustee, and founder of Bath Ironworks. It is a critical time. The last few weeks has changed the complexion and probabilities of many things. This is an opportunity and a test for the governor. I hope he sees this, and so then me. I believe he will act as he thinks right is. Well, whatever was right, it didn't involve Chamberlain. But that summer, now that his taste for politics was wet it again, he came back to politics this summer for real, because campaign for president was heating up, and Chamberlain, like many people in his wing of the Republican Party, which is known as at various times as the liberal wing, the independent wing, though it's actually the fairly conservative wing that disagreed with the radical Republicans. The veterans in that group had a hard time with Grant, because Grant was their leader, the military leader, the one that won the war in their eyes, and they wanted to support him at all times. But they weren't happy about his administration, about the rumors of corruption that came out of his administration and out of radical Reconstruction in the South. So, Hayes comes up, another veteran, general coming out of Ohio, Rutherford B. Hayes, as candidate, was a godsend to Chamberlain and people of his political views, because what he cared about were the things that these folks cared about. Civil service reform, deal with the corruption, home rule in the South, and some real sectional reconciliation. So in Chamberlain's words, in the accession of President Hayes, the people representing the American ideas have triumphed over party. So Chamberlain believed again. And in the process, he kind of got to fight back against the machine. He got involved in the campaign. He went to bat, basically, for Hayes. And in the campaign, like so many political campaigns at the time, the proverbial waving the bloody shirt was the type of politics that went on. It was vote the way you shot. You know, Republicans, they're the ones who won the war. Democrats are anti-war. So this was the basic way that for decades, party politics was sold in sort of symbolic ways, which many people found sort of distasteful. And after Hayes was inaugurated, Chamberlain wrote to Hayes, "You stand the champion of honest peace and constitutional liberty. The hopes of the country hang on the realization of those ideas. When in the conduct of the campaign, those principles, as announced by you, were supplanted by the untimely arousing of more sectional hate and the memories of a bitter war, and thus so far from hearing any principles suggested that were conservative and constructive, we were compelled to listen only to appeals to forces disintegrating and destructive. Those who had rejoiced in your nomination as restoring honor to the Republican Party were fearful of the results even of victory." Things were more tenuous at the time than we realized. The whole notion of the war being over in 1865 and everyone's happy back together. You know, there was a reason why Grant had his mantra, "Let us have peace." Well, naturally, the main machine, Republican machine, hated Hayes. Chamberlain worked actively with Hayes to make sure that his federal appointments in Maine would be of the Hayes-Chamberlain wing, not from the machine. So he vetted appointments, was always available to speak on Hayes' behalf. With this being politics, Chamberlain should get something for that, naturally. So what would he want? He wrote to the governor of Massachusetts, "I see the lines are going to be drawn here, and I for one mean to stand by the president. Being here in the college, I cannot help him as I might and would. I believe his policy, as I now understand it, is all that is going to save the country or the party. And I want to be recognized that I can have some reason or excuse for stepping forward into active politics. I do not know that I want any office in particular, nor in general, although I learned that highly influential friends in New England already mentioned me for the French mission to be ambassador to France. And if anything is to be said to the president, I want it to be strongly substantiated. The offer of an office would do more good, perhaps, than the office itself. I don't know of any office I would really care for other than that." Well, he didn't get that. It was given to the governor of Ohio. Instead, Chamberlain was put on the commission that would inspect the coins for the 1876 National Centennial. And Chamberlain's antagonism towards the main machine and his zealous support of Hayes may have actually been seen somewhat as a liability by the administration. So when one of the summers came up and there was going to be a fair number of, not a presidential campaign, but campaigning in general, summer being a big political time, Hayes shipped him to Europe. But it was fun. He went to attend the World's Fair in Paris as an education commissioner, and he was able to bring his family, went to France, went to England, and had a really good time. So it's not too bad. Well, what this teaches is that Chamberlain had the kind of leadership skills that fit certain environments, military environments, really, not political environments, and he didn't have that hunger, the real hunger you go out and reach for office with. All of his honors were basically thrown at him. He was a celebrity, he was a hero. He was basically put into office as governor, put into office as president of the college, and this would continue along. He's not very good at seeking office. He found it a bit distasteful to seek office. And it runs through his correspondence that this sort of led to mixed feelings. He thought it was distasteful to get office, but then he didn't really like the offices he got, and he thought himself deserving of being a senator, but he wouldn't do what it took. Never ran for the House, which he would have won by a landslide, but maybe it was below him. I don't know. But on the return to civilian life, which is always a hard thing, there's a quote that I'll paraphrase from the Shakespeare play Coriolanus, where Coriolanus is a general and is brought back to given a civilian leadership role, and he says basically nothing is as deadening to the soul as a chair. Well, Chamberlain had a rare opportunity that most people who get the chair don't get. He had a reprieve. There was a time, it was about 12 days, where he was able to be a hero again. In the election of 1878, at that time, there was a requirement in the Maine Constitution that to be elected governor, you had to win an absolute majority of the vote. No one had. And the Greenback Party was a big and powerful third party movement in Maine and nationwide. And third parties mattered more then than they do now. We don't really appreciate how relevant they were then. I mean, the Republican Party was a third party originally. Well, they allied with the Democratic Party, and together they were known as fusionists. And when the vote was thrown into the Maine legislature because there was no majority, the alliance of Greenbackers and Democrats elected a Democrat as governor. 1879, same thing happens. The Republican almost won. So it's going to go into the House. Well, the Republicans at this point won so many seats in the House that they would be able to elect a Republican to the governor seat. And Governor Garcelon and company decide that they don't really like that idea, so they're going to steal the election. So it's known as the count-out crisis. It's fairly complicated. It would take too long to explain. But the general gist was that at that time, votes were collected by a town, and then you could throw out a whole town's votes, basically, if you said something was wrong with it. And so they just looked at little things. You know, there would be if the person on the was voted for was, you know, John B. Smith, and on the ballot it said John Smith. Oh, those are two different people. Those votes don't count. Well, surprisingly enough, people caught on and saw what was happening, and armed bands descend on Augusta. The federal and state armories are raided. Everyone's grabbing muskets from the barns and heading up. All the thugs kind of saw a fight coming, so they went to. The governor realizes he had just created a firestorm, and so he calls in Chamberlain, who was at that time, the major general in charge of the state militia. So on January 9th, 1880, following that election, which had been in September, around the time when the new seats were supposed to be, everyone was supposed to be inaugurated into office, he writes to Fanny, "There is such confusion here, no governor and no legislature, that to prevent positive anarchy and mob law, I have been obliged to assume the defense and protection of the institutions of the state, as you will see by my proclamation to the people," which we perceive bears a very quiet and unassuming mien. "I do not dare to leave here a moment. There would most assuredly be a coup d'etat, ending in violence and bloodshed." I am determined that Maine shall not become a South American state. Well, there were thugs everywhere, there were weapons everywhere, there were armed bands, there was a rump legislature, and Governor Garcelon had also kind of hired some folks to defend the state house, and they were basically thugs. Chamberlain had thrown out. There's a Gatling gun sticking out the front door of the state house out to the park that's in front. It was full of people milling around. So several days later, another letter to Fanning. Yesterday was another round top. Although few knew of it. The bitter attack in the Bangor commercial calling me a traitor and calling on the people to send me speedily to a traitor's doom created a great excitement. There were threats all the morning of overpowering the police and throwing me out of the window. And the ugly crowd seemed like men who could be brought to do it, or to try it. Excited men were calling on me, some threatening fire and blood and begging me to call out the militia at once. But I stood it firmly, feeling sure of my arrangements and of my command of the situation. In the afternoon, the tune changed. The plan was to arrest me for treason. I should be kept in prison while they inaugurated a reign of terror and blood. They foamed and fumed away at that all evening. That plan failed. At about 11 p.m., one of the citizens came and told me I was to be kidnapped, overpowered, carried away, detained outside of people's knowledge, so that the rebels could carry on their work. I had the strange sense, again, of sleeping inside a picket guard. In the night, General Hyde, who I mentioned, of Bath, came up with 30 men, and Colonel Heath of Waterville with 50 men, sent for by Republicans, I suppose, and greatly annoying and embarrassing. There are too many men here afraid for their precious little pink skins. I shall have to protect them, of course. But my main object is to keep the peace and to give opportunity for the laws to be fairly executed. And this he did. Successfully. And considering that tensions were high, weapons were aplenty, and the thugs were roaming around, it's extraordinary that not only were no shots fired, no punches were thrown. He kept the peace. He arranged for the Supreme Judicial Court to make the decision as to who were the legitimate victors in the election. The Republicans won, and even the Democrat on the court voted in favor of the Republicans, unanimous vote. And you'd think that the Republican Party would have been happy about this. Chamberlain allowed them to win legitimately, and it looked like they won legitimately. No, they never forgave him because he had been impartial. He hadn't been partisan. He hadn't been there for them the whole time. They had even offered him the Senate seat for immediate recognition of their governor's candidate and their legislature, they would have made him senator. He refused. Thought that would be wrong. Democrats made the same offer to him. Refused them. And when the Democrats played nasty, Chamberlain called him out on it. Same thing the Republicans. They never forgave him. And it would haunt him now for the rest of his life. Starting out, because many, many of the leaders of the Republican Party had gone to Bowdoin. Many of them were trustees, they had serious influence at the college. So they kind of intruded into the academic politics to make his life more miserable. He was president for a few more years, didn't do a whole lot during that time, was more mundane. One thing he did was he built Memorial Hall in honor of Bowdoin graduates who had fought in the Civil War. You go in, there's a very large plaque in the foyer listing and honoring the names of Bowdoin's veterans who had fought in the Union. There's even a plaque honoring Bowdoin graduates who fought for the Confederacy. A little plaque was on the corner. doctor told him he needed to spend his winter somewhere warmer than Maine, and when he had renewed problems with the wounds, which plagued him incessantly. And just as a side note, when you think about the Civil War and its impact on veterans, whatever they might have from glory, pain, suppressed memories, post-traumatic stress disorder, and the glory days, people have a tendency not to forget their glory days and this general impact was always there from the Civil War. Well, Chamberlain, there was never a day that would go by that he wouldn't remember it, considering that he had those wounds that plagued him forever in many ways. And he also had some malaria that he picked up in the war that he had sometimes repeated bouts with. Well, he had a very intense need for surgery. So after 12 years, he resigned from the presidency of Bowdoin. Well, he's only 55 years old. He's a celebrity still. He's this war hero. And the title war hero, you carry that with you for the rest of your life. It's ambassadors get to call themselves ambassador for the rest of their life. Well, he's a war hero always. What could he do? He has the offers to be president of other colleges, but he doesn't want any more of that. Politics still, potentially, maybe, but no. Business. Railroad companies offered him positions, real estate companies. He was invited on all sorts of boards, corporate boards and not-for-profit boards. So the name looked great on letterhead. So Chamberlain kind of took a mix of things. He took jobs as running railroad companies in New York and Florida, real estate companies, real estate development programs in Florida, and he worked with some technology type companies that were dealing with such things as the motors, a lighter kind of motor for use on elevated train cars, like in the New York elevated trains. And these were in Florida, Boston, New York, Chicago. So he's traveling all over the place. Business savvy, not quite sure how good that was. Maybe he thought business would be good, because, you know, as a leader, he was used to having his orders followed. A little bit more of that happens in business. It's good. But then you have to know which orders to give, because you have to have business savvy to know where you want your company to go. He wasn't really a businessman. But always what would impact his ability to do any of this, considering he always overstretched himself, was his health. Could he physically do any of this? He wrote to his daughter in 1886, 58 years old at the time. I went down to the Wall Street office, and the moment I had secured the completion of the long pending business, I felt a sudden severe illness, first in my head, then in my limbs, then all over me. I rose to go, but sank into a chair. The kind friends there, not Wall Street sharks, I assure you, nor bulls and bears to me, took me, or led me, I could walk, to the nearest station of the elevated road. Halfway up, I had to go out on the platform to get a breath of the new northeast stormy air. The atmosphere in the cars made me deathly sick. I was home none too soon, for the moment I got out there, I threw up my breakfast, which he proceeded to describe in detail. When I got to the house, here the spasmodic congestive chills through the body, seemingly from hip to hip, were intensely severe, and my feet and hands grew cold as ice. I was enveloped in hot water bottles and flannels in bed. The doctors are called in, and I was soon seized with violent fits of vomiting, which made pretty thorough work of my stomach, and they thought afterwards may have saved my life, but I think that puts it rather strong. Meantime, I was given a hot water mustard foot bath, a fairly nasty home remedy of the time, where you took mustard grains and with a poultice, you pummel it up and put it in water, heat it, put it on your skin, basically causing it to rash and boils and intense pain, but it brought up the blood. They thought that was helpful. As did he, because he says, and in an hour or more, I was in a gentle perspiration, and the pains greatly relieved. Probably because he was focused on these other pains he had now. But I knew it was a sharp attack, and as the pains crept into the region of the heart, I did not know what was coming. The thought it best to give instructions about many things, and to give your address, and that of my home friends, and of many in the city, who would wish to be near me in case of need. They thought he was going to die. So his health has always been to hold him back. Now, meanwhile, when you read some of the correspondence of his business life, you have sort of a feeling like there's a parallel between this kind of high-tech boom then and the high-tech boom now. But, unfortunately, the 1890s had a bit of a parallel with the Silicon Valley bubble bursting. So he never made it rich, lost a fair amount of money, and as he's nearing 70 years old, he needed an income. He didn't really have any 401k to live on. So he needed a job. He needed a job that would basically to give him some money, not be too demanding, but also be something that he could feel sort of proud of. So there's a position open at the customs house, the Port of Portland. Now, the customs houses were important then, because before the advent of income taxes, most federal tax money came from customs. The top job at it is the collectorship, which is a high prestige job, the top patronage position in the state, from the administration position, as opposed to the judicial position. He had vast support for the job, because he's always this very popular celebrity war hero, the grand old man of Maine. Looks for the job, and didn't get it. He took it as an insult. As he wrote to a veteran friend of his, was given the number two job, the surveyorship. The surveyorship is a good little office, no doubt, and I ought perhaps to be thankful to get it, whether as a gift, a grace, or pity, or a sop to tender consciences, or a concession to a popular demand which I could not be wholly ignored. It is said to be an easy place, no responsibilities, no duties, no power, no prominence, no part in the governmental representation, and requiring no ability. Whether this description of the place should inflate my vanity when I am told that I am entitled to it is a question for the meek. To me, it suggests a free bed in a hospital. It was an insult. No doubt about it. The party refused to give him the job. But they couldn't ignore him. They still gave him the number two job. Though they added to the insult when both positions were open and they actually had to push out the incumbent surveyor to give it to Chamberlain. Well, he has his job for the rest of his life. It's an unpleasant job, but it doesn't demand an enormous amount of his time, although it did actually require him to be somewhat more physical than the collectorship would have. He had to actually go out onto the docks and measure barrels and things that there's no reason why anyone would want to do, and certainly not appropriate for an 80-year-old man to be out in the weather on ships measuring barrels of whatever. So what it comes down to is civilian life had been unsatisfactory. Other than that time when he saved the state from civil war, he was unhappy with civilian life. His leadership skills were not the kind of leadership skills that would translate easily to civilian life. He never really found a role where it might have. He had serious skills as a general. We don't know if he would have ever been a good strategic general. He never made it that high up into the totem pole, but he was a good tactical general. So, he spent more time thinking about the glory days, naturally. In the letter I mentioned earlier about politicians, when Chamberlain was writing from Washington, just before he went to Washington, on his way back from Florida, he visited Petersburg. And I spent 4 hours in trying to identify the spot where I fell on the 18th of June, 1864, and leading a charge upon the rebel works. All has changed there now. What was a solid piece of works through which I led my troops is now all cleared field. And the hillside, so smooth there, is now full with little clumps of trees, marking some spots made more rich, perhaps, by the bloody struggles enacted on them. You cannot imagine, I believe, what thoughts came over me. As I thought of all those who stood there on that day, for and against, and what it was all for, and what would come of it, and of those who on the one side and the other thought that there was something at stake worthy of dearest sacrifice. Such thought would never end, had one time to ponder. And it is well, perhaps, that the common cares and the inexorable duties of life call us away from too long thoughts. Well, I spent the next 32 years actively thinking about the war. Once he became surveyor, even more time, because he was bored. And then when his wife Fanny died in 1905, it became almost a full-time hobby. Much of the correspondence in the book is about this. It's about the creation of Civil War history, and about all of the different aspects of, in Chamberlain's life, not of, of the Civil War's impact. And in terms of doing Civil War history, there are many different aspects of it. A lot of it was social, frankly. There were veterans reunions, encampments, memorial services, and all these old friends got to hang out together. Now, one thing to remember is that unlike in the modern day, when you go down to the VFW hall, everyone who had fought would have fought in different units. Whereas in Civil War, units were recruited locally. So often, you had a bit of a mini reunion every time you went to church. These were great for bringing all sorts of people in, who, from all different regiments, that'd be Maine-wide or New England-wide, or go down to Gettysburg, and everyone who fought at Gettysburg was invited. They were great, fun, social. There's a political aspect to the veterans' work, too. The Grand Army of the Republic was the most powerful lobbying group in the country. They lobbied hard for pensions, veterans' benefits, medals of honor. Now, of course, they had a leg up because Congress was already full of veterans. You could look across, and it's just full of generals and colonels. They, together, thought about their glory days. For a lot of soldiers, they had it. Being with the guys was a really great part of their life, and they missed it. So much so that when the Spanish-American War came around, I'm convinced that an awful lot of the reason why we went into that war was because Congress was full of old veterans who missed the war, who wanted a chance to go hang out with the guys again. The leading generals in it, who might not have been on the field, but were a commanding general of the army, secretary of war, they were old veterans. And they were sort of concerned about these soft kids and their grandkids who had never really gotten tough. They'd never gone to war. They had this nice, pleasant existence living in a safe and healthy America. they never really developed their manhood. Their souls had not been touched with fire. So it would be good for them. Let's send those kids to war. Let's toughen them up. Let's make men out of them and have a good time at the same time. So we go off to war. Now, I mentioned that a lot of these folks are in positions of power. Well, your war record was the most important thing you had if you wanted to be elected a governor or senator, whatever it might be. So these folks fought hard to preserve their records. Sometimes that meant just kind of babysitting your record, because there are other people who try to steal and pull away. For some people, it involved outright lying. You look at Dan Sickles' life and the stuff that he made up. It's extraordinary. And the same thing happened in the South, and a lot of the creation of the Lee legend. People like Jubal Early just went out creating facts. Because how could their great leader have done something as idiotic as Gettysburg? Couldn't have been his fault. Must not have been his fault. Must have been someone else. So suddenly, they spent an awful lot of time creating scapegoats, like General Longstreet, who had his reputation just destroyed. Of course, he sort of brought it on himself, because as a Southerner, he supported the Republican Party in Reconstruction, which didn't go down too well with his other veterans. And there's another theme. These were folks, when they went to war, their grandfathers, their fathers, had fought in the American Revolution. They'd been part of the revolutionary generation. And this was the Civil War gave these people an opportunity to be the peers of their heroes. And not only that, they gave America its first real history. And battles like Gettysburg to be the peer of Waterloo. And then there was a sheer scholarship. A lot of people just wanted to do some history. So Chamberlain, a scholar by training, and these were his glory days, times when he felt most fully activated human being. He sort of, I think he created a new identity based on his experience in the war and wanted everything to live up to his best moments in the war, which was a grave miscalculation. He was really active in this. He was president of the Society of the Army of the Potomac. He was active in the Grand Army of the Republic, all sorts. Any veterans organization, you name it, he was in it. Active. He wrote a lot of articles on his experiences in each of the battles he fought in. He wrote a book called The Passing of the Armies, which is about the Appomattox campaign, the grand review of the army at the end of the war. Lectured widely on his experience. And his correspondence is full of discussions about this and of editing of books with other veterans. Putting together books like Maine at Gettysburg, which is a compendium of all the Maine experiences at Gettysburg. Then there was the issue of monuments. Every unit wanted to have their monuments. Now at Gettysburg, the rule was Union monuments could be at the furthest extent of where they fought. But Confederate monuments had to be where they started the day. Other side of the field. Well, the infighting that went on among units, between units, inside units, and then crossing the sectional divide was really astounding. Looking at the history of Gettysburg monuments is really wild. And William Oates, who was the colonel at the time of the 15th Alabama, which was the 20th Maine's main opponent at Little Round Top, wanted to have a monument for the 15th Alabama. And he wanted it at Little Round Top. He didn't want it on the other side of the battlefield, which Chamberlain had no problem with. But you got to put it in the right place. And they were getting down to pretty serious details of how many feet forward. How anyone could remember any of this is beyond anyone's calculation. Smoke and fire and haze and trying to realize, well, yeah, I think you got up to here. Let me measure that one out. But he wrote to Oates to express his complete and cordial willingness to have the monument of the 15th Alabama placed within my lines on the slope of Little Round Top. on ground actually reached by portions of that regiment in the sharp passages of the fight. As to exact location, I cannot say from mere description what was the extreme point to which my left was driven by you, but certainly it was not doubled back upon my right, nor was the right driven materially from its connection with the 83rd Pennsylvania. I should say it was to a perpendicular with the line of my right front, that is a quarter circle. The losses, both in my right companies and in the 83rd, show that they were not sharply assailed. It is really my desire to have your monument set up. Only let us make sure of the ground for the sake of historical fact. A lot of those battles went on, and unfortunately, so I'm not entirely sure why, Oates lost the fire to deal with these fights, and there's no monument to the 15th of Alabama. So you have lots of letters like this, dealing with specific facts, trying to handle some of the commotion that was going on among the veterans, and then also just the sheer joy that he got as a scholar, being a historian of his own events, something he had taken part in. And some of the letters discuss the challenges of history, the limited awareness of what was going on around you, the recognizing that the official reports might have limited value, or they might even be skewed to so that the general in charge could say it's a big victory for whatever publicity purposes you might want to get out of that. You have fading memories, exaggerations, accidental or intentional. And everybody wants a piece of the action. So as he wrote to Ellis Speer, a veteran officer in the 20th Maine, served under Chamberlain, he writes about a couple people who were in the 20th Maine who claim themselves to have led the charge of Little Round Top. One is Holman Melcher. The Melcher incident is also magnified. He is now presented to the public as having suggested the charge. There is not truth in this. I had communicated with you before he came and asked me if he could not advance his company and gather in some prisoners in his front. I told him to take his place with his company, that I was about to order a general charge. He went on the run and did, I have no doubt, gallant service. But he did no more than many others did. You, for instance, on whom so much responsibility devolved in bringing up the left wing and making it a concave instead of a convex line, in the sweeping charge. There is a tendency nowadays to make history subserve other purposes than legitimate ones. Then he mentions Walter Morrill. Now it seems that it was Morrill who won the battle. He did good and praiseworthy work. But the whole truth is sometimes quite different in its bearings from what is called truth. And to make a part truth displace the whole is not in accordance with old-fashioned ethics. And if any of you like reading battle memoirs by any veteran, keep in mind that there are real problems in how they wrote it, what their memory would be, if they were lying, if they were basing their stuff honestly on other things that were lies or made up or wrong, and they build up this nasty sandcastle. It's hard to know what happened. But learning about how these histories were created teaches an awful lot about the veterans' lives after the war. And it applies to all history. So from Chamberlain's letters, something we can learn, other than the fact that he's a pretty good writer, is that the life of a war hero was actually fairly hard. For though he had an amazing amount of opportunities, the sheer number of opportunities would make him demand more, expect more from life. And the mere having of glory days makes you aware of their lack of presence today. So they're both a burden and a joy. And in terms of the Civil War's impact on his life, it was daily up until the day that he died from his Civil War wounds at age 85. The are the letters of a scholar and a hero and a man just trying to deal with the... They're pretty fun to read. Thanks.
Last letter he wrote, and to whom, what was it about?
It's to his...
And how long before he died?
The exact.
And do we know for a certitude that that is the last letter?
No. We don't. You can never know. His last one is to his sister. It's dated a couple weeks before he died. And it's a three-line letter saying, "Your very interesting letter with enclosures gratefully received. I'm gaining strength, but slow work. The bed and bedside chair are still my habitual place. Have to keep a trained nurse for a while yet. Love to all." It was dictated. A month before that, he wrote one there. It's where it really talks more about his experience at the end. It says to his sister, "I am passing through deep waters. The doctor thinks I'm going to land once more on this shore. I seem to be gaining deliverance from the particular disease which caused me such unspeakable agony, gaining strength from the condition to which it reduced me. We are gradually discharging doctors and nurses." But then further on he says, "If the dear Lord has appointed me to live a little longer, I am resolved it shall be of good to me and of others. I am trying to get a little closer to God and to know him better. Also,
if I'd like to get a copy of that.